I'd like to thank everybody for coming, and we've got some speakers tonight, so I'd like to pass the mic off to Christian Jones.
I teach third grade at Lake Elementary School in San Pablo, and I'm also, of course, a member of the United Teachers of Richmond and elementary director on the executive board, and just happy to be here to continue the conversation about charter schools and how they impact public schools in West Contra Costa Unified School District. I'd say we started the discussion about charter schools maybe 4 or 5 months ago on the executive board of our union. We were busy with contract negotiations and bargaining, so that took up, I think, a lot of time on the executive board. but the issue came out, and we had a few educational meetings at Richmond Public Library about charter schools. And then recently at our last rep council, we passed a resolution against charter schools. So yeah, that was a pretty big deal for us. And we also, the resolution included an educational campaign to educate teachers in the community about the impact of charter schools. So it's probably gonna be a lot more meetings to educate teachers about the issue, because we also need to learn more about the issue. It's definitely been a learning process. I'm not sure what else to say. Welcome. I guess I'll just say, as a teacher, this year I have about 16 boys and 6 girls in my classroom, and the other third grade teachers have about the same ratio. So one has 17 boys and 8 girls, and the other has maybe 15 boys and 6 girls. And so we were talking about, well, why is that happening? It's very unusual. It could just be naturally that year that there were that many more boys born than girls. So I talked to my neighbor, who's a scientist, and she agreed that that was actually what happened. And I talked to other teachers and said it's pretty unusual to have that kind of gender balance. And so I started asking the students themselves, well, what happened to the girls that were in your classroom? We went back all the way to kindergarten. And what the kids weren't told me that the girls had gone to other schools. So some of the girls left in first grade, some of them left in second grade. And so I think the conclusion that I came to was that the girls had been picked off by local charter schools, because maybe the girls appeared to be, that they had more potential to achieve. So I'm not sure if this pattern is going to repeat or this is just kind of an anomaly, but it just goes to show you that charter schools can throw off even the gender balance in your classroom. So what else can I say? Not sure what else to say, other than I think I'd be interested in hearing other teacher voices and see what other teachers' experiences are in the classroom. I know we've all had the experience of really working hard with a student who comes in. Maybe the student had sort of average scores in reading, and then you spent time with them in a small group and pulled them to the side and really did a lot of work with them on comprehension and phonics and all that. And then you notice by the end of the year that they've really improved, and now they're a proficient student. So you feel good about your accomplishment. But then you notice the following year, what happened to that student? They're no longer at your school, and they've gone to a charter school. So it can be a little disappointing as a teacher when you worked hard with students, and then they kind of disappear. So I know we've had that experience. We've also had the experience of having charter recruiters come to our school and ask the principal if they could pass out flyers to recruit students from the charter school. And thank goodness the principal at my school was smart enough to say, no way, I'm not gonna let you pass out flyers for your school. I can also say that I think this was happening before it became apparent that charter schools were taking our students, but I think for the last maybe 3 or 4 years, the schools in West Contra Costa Unified School District have really been making an effort to partner with the community. We have a lot of services we offer students at the school. We have a lot of parent volunteers come into the classroom. And just in terms of our instruction, we've tried to make the classroom instruction more relevant to students so they're more engaged, more excited. My classroom partners with Bay Area Audubon Society. We go on several field trips looking at the watershed at Point Pinole and also at Wildcat Canyon, Alvarado Park in Richmond. And we also have another partnership with another community group that's focused on environmental education. In addition, we partner with, we have an arts curriculum that we partner with Richmond East Bay Center for the Performing Arts. So we've done African dance and integrated the arts. So that's just to say that I think teachers in traditional public schools or public schools are really doing their best to sort of make the curriculum more relevant and make, and one way I kind of hate to say this, but really what we're trying to do is make our classrooms and our schools sort of a destination spot for children. So they'll really want to come to our schools. I mean, not just, you know, I mean, a lot of the propaganda that our schools are failing is wrong, but at the same time, we're trying to do what we can to really make sure that every student has a chance to succeed and that every student has an opportunity. Also, of course, as public school teachers, we don't we try to kick students out of the school. I think, I'm not a principal, but I think it's very hard to expel someone from a public school. It's like a really long process, and I don't think it happens very often. But if you contrast that to charter schools, they do get rid of their students, and they, that, if they're not achieving. And if they do get rid of their students for small behavior problems. And some of those students, most of those students end up coming back into a public school. So usually around springtime, we'll have students come back to the public school. And when I talk to some of the students, they report that they were really stressed out by being at the charter school. And they're happy to be back at public school. About it. Oh, and I want to introduce a few people and have someone come up to speak. And it's Diane Maddox. She can come up. She's the incoming secretary of the United Teachers of Richmond, and she's going to be on the executive board coming up. She can talk about her what she does.
I was going to get dressed like a school teacher this morning, and then I heard that Sanders was going to have Bill McKibben start helping him, and I got inspired to put my 350.org t-shirt on. And the reason why I became an activist was because I've taught in public schools for 30 years, and I've watched the policies of the money trickling up to the top take its toll on my time and money. So it's like, not only has my children's future been stolen, but my present was stolen. I have to refer to my notes because I've actually written a book about my profession, and you're either going to be the hook to take me off or I'm going to forget what I'm saying. So it culminated at one point, my falling asleep at the wheel with my children in the car, and I had to cut out their extracurricular sports. And just recently, I had to use the money I was going to use for them to go to school, help them go to school, to buy a house because rents are going up at 15% a year, and my salary was, flat. So I know that it's not just our profession. I'd heard on KPFA that the oldest union in Mexico, the Electrical Workers Union, was nationally owned, and they started to divest in it, just like Prop 13 has caused divestment in education. And there were outages, and people were upset with the quality of service, so it was just ready for a privatization, a takeover. And I thought to myself, you know, that's what's happening to my profession. And I found out this year that 40% of Oakland is already charter. So you know, wouldn't Noam Chomsky say that the only countervailing force to corporate tyranny is organized labor? And teachers are the largest union in the nation, so what a perfect target to break us up, because 40%, there's half of the schools, half of the district, half of the union, half of our pension, and, you know, a force to be reckoned with, half of the force to be reckoned with is taken out. And the impact on students, you know, if we don't have democracy and transparency, the very, you know, building codes or the land could be an earthquake fault, or it could be toxic, or the teachers aren't, their background check isn't, you know, done, or, you know, that there's no school board to redress problems to, or, you know, no accreditation for me preparing to go to school. You know, it's just the impacts on everyone are enormous, and I could go on and on and on. So this week, finally, our union passed a resolution to come out against charters. You know, and as I said to my friend, that's like being on the Titanic and finally lowering the lifeboats into the water. And we are going to have an education campaign and research task force, and get involved with the Labor Fest. Mr. Zeltzer is giving me ideas on how we can do that. And we endorsed a pro public school board member. We're gonna get out there with the Richmond Progressive Alliance and work. And I guess that's all I have to say for now. Move on to the next speaker.
Eastern Elementary, which I've been there 10 years. It's right next to Richmond College Prep. And I'm just gonna talk a little bit about Eastrom. For 10 years, we've seen our kids culled the top, maybe fourth of the class each October when they decide they have openings. A couple kids from every class are sent over or are told that they can go to Richmond College Prep. And in the meantime, I had one class with five African American boys who self-described themselves as being kicked out of Richmond College Prep. And this is, every teacher can tell you this, this has been going on for 10 years. And in the meantime, we had a principal who was, I really believe that we were set up. The Harbor Way, which was the school for the suspended and expelled kids, was shrunk to 8 kids and put in Pinole. And it happened right on our city block. And it was closed. A lot of those kids ended up in Nystrom. Our staff was cut, no vice principal, no instructional specialist. The class sizes jumped up. We had 28 kids in kindergarten, first, second, third grade, and 33 in fourth, fifth, and sixth. We had brand new teachers, Teach for America teachers, who were there 2 years and split. We had a principal who was calling the cops. At the end, she was there for 3 years, calling the cops daily. And I think that principal was put there. Nobody is that dysfunctional. She was a smart woman. But to drive the parents to the charter schools, cops were on the campus daily at the, that last semester that she was there. She had assistant principals to help her. She had educational services people there to order textbooks after years of not having textbooks, and there were lawsuits. Why did they leave that principal there for 3 years? And in the meantime, parents are coming to the school district and saying how dysfunctional the district schools are. The district, just you all know this probably, but the district had a $40 million debt in that we were paying off for 20 years. At that time, California was the 48th of the 50 states. We were getting about $7,000 per student from the state. New York State was getting $20,000 to $26,000 per student at the same time for their kids. And the flat land schools were getting less money than the hills. It's been a constant struggle in our district. So yeah, then the crash came. And we were cut even more. Class sizes went way large. And that was for the last, since 2008, right, for the last 8 years. And then finally, Jerry Brown comes in and is giving this district, because 70% of the kids in our district, 75%, qualify with the LCFF funding. We're getting all this money. The Contra Costa Times said 45% more money from the state. And although there's federal and parcel tax, 80% of the district budget, the general budget, is from the state. So 45% more money from the state the last couple of years. And the charter schools come in and are taking, basically draining the money. So we're still not seeing that money in our schools. When the parents complain, yes, it's because there's a focus only on the test, there's not enough staff, the class sizes are too big, and there's bullying in the schools. But this is absolutely the wrong way to fix it, to have a two-tier system, charters and public schools, to have the kids culled, who are the most functional and the most supported and the most stable families, culled out of our classrooms. And the local public schools are left with the kids. Homelessness is a big issue in Nystrom. Hunger, I mean, you know, kids who don't have glasses, whose teeth hurt, I mean, it's still, poverty is insidious, and it's very difficult for the kids, of course. I mean, that's a given. But, so, I just wanted to point out some things to you. According to Ballopedia, which is the Encyclopedia of American Politics, it's on the web, internet. You all know this, maybe, but it says the West Contra Costa School Board election of November 2014 featured the largest amount of money of any November 2014 school board race in the United States. Candidates raised contributions from groups themselves, $577,000, more than $500,000 on our race. And 292,000 of that was just for Cuevas and Block. Education Matters, which is charter school, and the charter school lobby. And I don't know how Cuevas has the nerve to say that she wasn't supported by the charter school lobby. And after that, this district in a year and a half has six more charters, or 13 charters in our district. And that ADA that they get is taken away from the general budget. But it's more than that. If you can just bear with me, the charters can locate, they have no ed code to build with. They're using non-union labor. Of course, the teachers are not unionized, although leadership is AFT, not CTA. It's very hypocritical that No Child Left Behind claimed to instigate greater accountability on traditional public school teachers and schools while paving the way for an expansion of charter schools with far less accountability. We call them public charter schools when in reality they're private schools with governmental contract. But it's more than that. They're making money off of building the schools that No Child... Oh, I'm so sorry. I have all this a little bit. This is a report that says LA Charter siphoned away almost $500 million from the public school students. So LA School District is one of the largest school districts in the country. They're aiming to have Eli Broad is promoting 50% charter schools in the near future. Which the LA Times uncovered some secret report of his. But right now, $500 million are being siphoned out of the local public school. So not only is it unjust to the kids that there's capable kids and kids who are struggling to a two-tier school district, but what a ridiculous way to operate a school situation, a district with, you double the operating costs with that two-tier system. Okay, well, I'm not organized enough for this, but, here it is. Sorry. This is democracy now. I think I've read this before, but it says, he's saying, and this is old, this is 2010, he's talking about New York. And he says, Amy, one of the things I've been trying now for a couple years to try to figure out is why so many hedge fund managers, wealthy Americans at big bank, Wall Street banks have executive, are all lined up supporting and getting involved in the development of charter schools. And he says there's a lot of money to be made. He's not talking about for-profit management. He's talking about that at the end of the Clinton administration, they passed something called the New Markets Tax Credit, and it gives an enormous federal tax credit to banks and equity funds that invest in community projects and underserved communities, and especially it's been used by the charter schools. What happens is the investors put up the money to build the charter schools, and they basically can double their money in 7 years through a 39% tax credit from the federal government. And then there's, but the taxpayers are ultimately paying off the bonds, right? So they're just fronting the money. This is a tax credit on money that they're lending, so they're collecting interest on the loans as well as getting the 39% tax credit. They piggyback the tax credit on other kinds of federal tax credits, like historic preservation of or job creation. Historic preservation was the Rosie the Riveter thing, right? Or job creation or brownfield credits. The result is you can put $10 million in it in 7 years, double your money. So this is a big issue, is they're not being audited. No one knows who's making these huge windfall profits, but Richmond is designated as, oh, I forget the term, but LISC, L-I-S-C. It is one of the places that qualify for these loans. And it doesn't matter that it's not downtown Richmond or North Richmond, anywhere in Richmond. They build charters, they qualify for these credits. So, and this is just one of the credits. I mean, there's somebody told me there were 60-something credits for charter school construction. Jerry Brown has earmarked all of this money for running the charter schools that's not available to our district. So the long and short of, it's a ripoff for our kids, it's a scam. It's just really shocking. And of course they can build where this is from EdSource. They say Richmond charters located where Chevron previously stored tanks filled with petroleum, prompting concern that children may be exposed to dangerous chemicals. Part of this area was, this is the hilltop, this here. Part of the area was cleaned up for residential standards and part was cleaned up for commercial standards, but this was done in the 70s. Standards have been considerably updated since then. To be dumping kids onto these sites without detailed evaluation is potentially a risky proposition. Parents and educators have no clue what is in the ground and what needs to be done. We have to exercise an abundance of caution. So there you go. Leadership completely built with district money, housing a charter school. Kennedy, the teachers don't have enough outlets in their classrooms, hasn't been touched or remodeled or renovated for 40 years. Teachers don't have enough electrical outlets for the technology that they're supposed to be using. I mean, I gotta cut it short. But.
Well, my name is Chris Rosky, and I'm also a teacher in this district, and I've taught at Coronado Elementary, or have taught for 12 years there. And you know, there's a lot of things I wanted to say about this situation. Let me check my notes. I have my little post-it in here. But the main thing that I wanted to talk about, I want to start with the perspective that I see, you know, the entire thing taking, which is that we've got a situation here where,
hang on, so, do laundry, dishes.
Okay, good. So, you know, as I look at the city of Richmond or the district, and it's a great illustration of what's wrong with our society, which is the situation of structural inequality in society. You know, the schools in Richmond are not nearly as good as the schools in Orinda, and that's the way the system is set up to work. Even in this district, the schools in the hills are much better than the schools. I mean, you can make the argument that they're much better than the schools that are closer to the west, that are in the flats. And so I think about that, the fact that you've got a system that's created in this country to make some people wealthier than others, And we all, and that system at this point is perpetuated here in the educational system, where you've got people who are very wealthy and they spent their entire lives enriching themselves and preying on other people using the mechanisms of the financial industry or the construction industry or whatever industry they're in. And they can come into our city, our district, and they can use their power and relative wealth to perpetuate that system of inequality. And to say, we're going to take all these kids out of the public school system, we're going to take all these resources out of the public school system and put them in our, they call it public school system, but we're going to put it in our school. And so in other words, to make the situation even worse in the public schools. So they're using that system of inequality to perpetuate that very same system. And I think it's disgusting. And I think it's fraud. I think that I don't want to make a blanket statement on all charter schools. I mean, there's a charter school in Berkeley that a lot of my students from Coronado went to. They're very happy there. Some of them are. Some of them left. You know. But you know, the guy who started it has a PhD in education. He was an educator, and that gives him a lot of credibility. You know, you can start a school, and I mean, there is a mechanism called charter schools, which has credibility, which says we're going to try something new. If you're in education for your whole life, and you come to a point where you feel like the system is limiting you, and you want to start a charter school, that's a legitimate process, and it shouldn't be condemned. But if you've spent your whole life making money in one way or another, and it's suddenly at some point you say, what I really want to do now is educate children in Richmond, that's going to cause a lot of people to speculate what your real motives are. So I think it's pretty easy to say, without knowing the details, that it's fraud. And we should all be against educational fraud. So, the other thing I want to say was that I want to just, as far as speaking points go, I think we need to hone our message. You know, I'm an educator, I've been an educator all my life. I started teaching when I was 15 years old at a Boy Scout camp, and that's all I've done ever since. So that's 30 years of teaching. I should be able to retire. But they won't let me. But, you know, what I want to say is that, you know, there's a lot of talk about the kinds of kids the charter schools take and the kinds of families that they come from. And I think it's important to remember that two things. One is that a lot of the students, not all, but a lot of the students at the charter schools, that was their best option, or that appeared to be their best option to their parents. And so we certainly don't want to condemn those families. It's been said more than once, but we don't want to hold it against the families for making choices. But the other thing I want to say is that there's a lot of families, well, thousands of families, if you think about it, who still have their parents in the public schools of this district. And it's really important not to imply that those parents are simply ignorant or unable to move their kids out of the public school system. Because there is an issue of loyalty to the public school system that a lot of people have, including myself. And this is a smart place, right? We're in Richmond. Like, we fought back Chevron. Like, we know the RPA is represented here, right? You guys fought back on the biggest industry, the biggest corporations in the world, who had millions of dollars of funding, right? Yeah, give it up for the RPA, because that's what they did, right? And they did it in a community like Richmond, where people here, you can't hypnotize these people. I mean, they're educated, and they've been through it, and they know this, you know, the importance of a good public education and how that's an organization of liberation, or it can be. So I just want to point out that I think it's really important that we give credit to the parents who still have their children in the public school system as a conscious choice, not as an unconscious choice, but as a conscious choice of saying, this is where I want my kids, I'm going to support my public school because I know that's the right place they should be. So give those parents credit, and those people need to be our allies. You know, and right now, right here, we've got a lot of people who are, you know, maybe don't have kids in the public school system. I do, but, you know, maybe your kids are already grown. But it's important that, you know, if you want to support the public schools, then do that. Go into the public schools and volunteer, give them money, provide them with resources, mentor, and encourage other people to do the same thing, be part of the process. And let's make the public schools in this district so good that the fraudulent charter schools will simply dry up.
Thank you. John Armiger, a 20-year employee, teacher at Pinole Middle School, 7th grade, UTR Executive Director. Want to talk about a huge public school success. Nobody knows about this. In 2003, there were 60,000 California 8th graders proficient and advanced in Algebra 1. In 2013, there were 135,000 California 8th graders proficient and advanced. That is a massive improvement. Algebra 1 is the linchpin course in the math sequence. Why isn't this recognized? It's false that public schools are failing. However, any charter discussion has to recognize that many parents are unhappy with the district. The district must deal realistically with its climate and academic programming issues. But those stem from an incompetent and dishonest administration. Now, the reasons that the district needs to deal with these are as follows. Charters represent the global shrinking of publicly controlled space, a shift in control of resources from public to private is happening at every level of government all over the world and has been for a generation now. Our primary identity is shifted from citizen to consumer. The charter phenomenon is part of this. Education is perceived as a market choice for consumers. Instead of developing citizenship with all the rights and responsibilities for decision-making that citizenship represents, the consumer is a politically lobotomized citizen. I think this is why so many of us are intuitively and instinctively against charters. Every charter student has an educationally interested family. That must be the case, because charters require an application process to attend. So the charter claims of student population equivalency are false. And as charters grow, the proportion of students with educationally disengaged families will grow in the authentic schools. In the case of the Adams hijacking, the irony of Caliber claiming to support its students is glaring, given that they do not have to pay union scale for their seismic upgrade. The fiscal constraints of charters are obviously different. Authentic public schools carry out the social justice will of the people, which is to pay union scale. How can cutting the wages of working people, many of whom could be expected to come from the community the students come from, be considered supporting the community? Money is where the rubber meets the road in any social justice discussion. I'm the LCAP chair. These charter schools are taking these educationally interested parents from school site councils. We can't get quorums on site councils. We need these educationally interested parents to take advantage of the new democratic machinery represented by LCAP and the local control funding formula. All these educationally interested parents are being trained. So charters are cancer on our publicly controlled democracy.
And our next speaker is Steve Zeltzer.
Steve Zeltzer, I'm with the Repeal Charter School Law Campaign and United Public Workers for Action. I want to thank you all for coming today. Our work over the last 5 or 10 years has been to begin a campaign to educate working people and the labor movement and the public about the dangers of privatization. And it's not just privatization in schools, it's the post office, it's public services, all areas are being privatized for profits. And I'm glad I was called by Art. I want to thank Art for getting this church. And he should talk about his experience as a carpenter, because as a millwright rather, because and in the carpenters union, because right across the way here is a giant school, Aspire School, two schools, right here, Hilltop, Richmond, And these schools were built non-union, and the Carpenters Union was picketing them. And they promised, apparently, to the neighborhood council that they would be union, the operator of Aspire schools. Of course, they lied. And a lot of these charter operators lie once they get their foot in. This is not unique. There are many schools, and I've been traveling around the state in shopping malls now. And what they're doing is they're setting up a school in a shopping mall, and they put some computers in the room, and they say that's a school, and they're getting state funding for that. Now, how can you set up some computers in a shopping mall store, bring in students that have maybe one teacher, and call that a school? This is not a school. This is a scam, is what it is. It's really a scam of public education. Yet that's going on statewide. And I first became involved, particularly in education, with a woman named Kathleen Carroll, who was a lawyer for the California Teachers Credentialing Commission, CTC. And she noticed that there was a backlog of teachers getting credentialed. Hundreds of thousands of teachers weren't getting credentialed. And the commission was saying, well, we can't credential these teachers because maybe they were arrested. They were giving all kinds of excuses about why they couldn't be credentialed. So it was a scandal. And she said, look, this has to stop. These teachers' lives are being ruined because they were waiting to get jobs, and they couldn't get the jobs unless they get the credentials. So she raised that with the legislature. There was an audit. She was fired, and her case is still in court. And Jerry Brown and Kamala Harris are fighting her, this public employee who stood up for a properly run commission on teacher credentials. So when she was fired, what did she do? She started to investigate who is running the commission on teacher credentials. She discovered it was privatizers. And the plan was to prevent teachers from getting credentials so they'd be forced to work for charter schools. I think that's criminal. When you prevent teachers from getting credentials so they're forced to work into a charter school, that's another scam. The woman that was head, Ting Sung, of the Commission on Teacher Credentials, runs a school in Natoma School in Sacramento. She was working with the Gulen clan. And this is another issue about charter schools. Religious groups are building charter schools. There's the Gulen Magnolia chain in California. There's a Escondido Charter High School where the coach, his name is Dennis Snyder, was requiring the athletes and the cheerleaders to pray to play. They couldn't play unless they prayed in his church, an evangelical church. He kicked a student, he was fired, and then he said, well, after the 1990 charter laws passed, I'll set up my own charter school. He's now running not one charter school, but a chain of charter schools in Escondido, including the shopping mall schools. And of course, they are religious, and they're drawing students from parochial schools. So why should somebody pay to go to a parochial school when you can send them to a Christian charter school funded by us, the taxpayers? So this person, Ting Sung, who is running the Commission on Teacher Credentials, even though there was a scandal at the CTC, what happened to her? She was appointed by Governor Jerry Brown to be on the Board of Education. This is the reward that she had for the corruption that was going on in the Commission on Teacher Credentials. And what is the Board of Education doing? The Board of Education is approving charters that communities don't want. This charter here in the Adams School is not wanted by the community. I mean, to bring in 800 students to drive them individually up to a school, it's going to destroy the neighborhood. And also, they're already schools there, K through A. So they're going to, even if it gets disapproved by the school board, it can be appealed to the county, and then it can be appealed to the state board of education. And they're using the manipulation of the laws which they've written to basically impose charter schools and privatization on all of us. And we feel that there needs to be a statewide political education campaign, and the UTR is taking that up. This is not, and it's actually a national, international issue. It's not just us, it's happening all over. And I think the poster child of the charter school movement is about doing good is Ron Beller. Because that's who I learned about when Mark called. I said, you know, who is this? What is this caliber school? You know, I mean, who's gonna build this? So I started looking into this guy, Ron Beller. And it turns out Ronnie was working for Goldman Sachs as a hedge fund operator, the Peloton Fund in England, with his wife, Jennifer Moses. And they actually had the notoriety of going bankrupt, the first major hedge fund, subprime mortgage hedge fund, that went bankrupt in 2008. The reason that was a big issue is because they went bankrupt the day before the quarter, which means all the other hedge funds had to download their value as a result of the bankruptcy of the Peloton Fund. So $17 billion were lost, and it turns out another reason for his notoriety is they had a secretary at the firm who stole 4 million pounds, and they didn't know about it. They have so much money that, so they sued her, and there was a trial in England about what was going on with her theft. And in the trial, it turns out that Jennifer Moses spent 500,000 pounds going to Italy to celebrate her 40th birthday, that she was going shopping in New York and with using this money. And basically they said after the scandal, she was gonna work for the Brown, Gordon Brown, who was the prime minister, as an American privatizing in England. They're ideologues, they're political ideologues who believe that the market can solve all problems. Bring the market in, it'll solve your problem. So they decided after their scandal and the collapse of the Peloton Fund that they were gonna go to the United States, according to their friends, to do good. That was where they were going. Where do they go? They go to New York, and he starts working for Joel Klein, who's the superintendent of the New York school system, and pushing in a capacity in which he wasn't paid by the city, so that they didn't know what he was doing. He was one of these consultants, and the consultants are all over the place. There are thousands, literally thousands of consultants in California helping our education system, supposedly. And they're getting money from these, you know, billionaires, really. And they're pushing privatization. So he was involved in pushing Teach for America. He was involved in helping to privatize the New York City education system. And then he came out here and decided to do more good, setting up the Caliber chain with a board. And if you look at the board of the Caliber chain, it was being passed out at the last meeting of the board. They're hedge fund operators. There's a billionaire, the head of the Fortress Fund in San Francisco. And this is a school board, quote unquote school board, public school board, that voted to stop the teachers being able to get the California state teacher retirement system. In other words, teachers at the caliber schools can no longer be in the state pension system. And that's happening at charter schools throughout the state. They don't want the state teachers' pension fund, so they're undermining the entire pension system of the teachers in California. Because the more teachers that go out of the pension fund, the less money and the greater crisis it is. So I interviewed Ron. I was surprised he was interested in being interviewed at the last meeting. And I asked him, why did you vote to get rid of the state teachers' pension program? He said, I'm not a lawyer. That's what he told me, I'm not a lawyer. Well, he voted for this. I mean, if he's not a lawyer, but he's on a board making decisions like that, I guess he's not qualified to be on a school board, because that's the responsibility of the school board to do it. And he also said it was approved by the county. Now, who approved it? We don't know, because the minutes of these privately run charters are not in there like in a regular school district. In a regular school district, the minutes, the records, the letters, it's all there. You know what's happening. You have the right to know what's happening. That's not the case. And a lot of this construction that's going on is by friends, cronies. Who is this guy with the development company that wants to build it?
Chamberlain.
Now, he's another guy who's trying to do good. And his idea of doing good is to build charter schools and then rent them out, lease them out, and he gets money for that. And he's also building non-union, and you know, this is something that we have to do. We have to link up with all the unions in West Contra Costa, all the unions in California, and say this isn't just about the teachers. What we discovered in this Aspire school is that they were bringing in workers from Nevada and paying them $15 an hour. Now, aren't there a lot of unemployed youth, young people who need jobs in Richmond, right here in West Contra Costa? Why do they have to go to Nevada to get workers and then pay them $15 an hour? They're undercutting the very people they say that they want to help, poor working class people who need good jobs. The unions are excluded. There are no service workers who are unionized at any of the charters. It's a union busting operation, completely. So we have to organize all the unions in West Contra Costa to organize to say no to charters. You cannot approve a charter. It's an attack on the labor movement. And if we do that, we can stop them. There are a lot of unionized workers, but they're not educated. We went to the carpenters meeting and had a rally for Hillary Clinton, and we leafleted them, and a lot of them don't know about what's going on in the charter. So it's our responsibility to do the education, not only among ourselves, teachers, education workers, but also all working people. You're being affected. So we're going to have a conference in July, on July 30th, as part of Labor Fest, a statewide education conference. And there's some good developments. The NAACP has passed a resolution statewide to call for a moratorium on charters because they're resegregating the schools in California. So we're going to try to have them come here. Also, the Anaheim School Board has passed a resolution calling for a moratorium on charters. And because the Magnolia chain, this Gulen chain, wanted to build a bunch of charters there in the community. So we're going to try to get this, have a statewide conference, have these speakers, and stream it live so people throughout the state can watch it and get educated. Our job is education, particularly about privatization and charters. If we can't educate ourselves, then we're not going to be able to educate the public. And a lot of people are confused about charters. And one of the reasons is the corporate media is controlled by the charters. The billionaires are saying charters are good. I mean, they're doing good things. In fact, you know, the way, only way you can get a good education in California is to go into a lottery. Now, what kind of ideology is that? I mean, I grew up in California when it had the best education system in the world. I grew up when it cost me $72 to go to state college. And now young people have to go into debt, $60,000, $70,000 to go to college. This is in a state where you have over 100 billionaires. You have over 100 billionaires, and we can't have free public education in California for our young people? We have to make them be paupers and go into debt? This is what we're talking about. It means going after the billionaires who have the money and saying, we're going to have the best public education in the world. Everybody will be able to go for free. And we're going to have great paid teachers, we're going to have a great system, and we're not going to be destroyed by privatization, which is really wrecking our public education system. And we don't have a lot of time, because they've been working at this for 20, 30 years. One woman, I did a video of the first meeting at the Mira Vista school. She called me up and said, you censored us out. And you censored me out, and you don't want our story to get out. Well, I looked up her up, who she was. She was a supporter of Mira Vista, but also she was a supporter of Milton Friedman. These people are ideologues. This is not just a question of profit. They ideologically believe in the free market. They ideologically are against unions. And that's what they're propagating. They're saying to people, we don't want unions. We don't want workers having any power. We want a free market in which the rich people, Ron Bell and others, decide for us what's best for our kids and best for our future. That is not choice, but that's exactly what is going on.
Good evening. I really didn't intend to speak this long. Primarily because, I was Jerry Yoshida. I'm a retired planner at a school in Berkeley system in San Francisco State. My concern is what's happening with charter schools from a land use standpoint. The charter school administrators are really pushing to allow no obstructions oversight as to where they go. So they're proposing them in industrial areas, in commercial areas, as you know, Pier and Hilltop, and also six of your light industrial sites.
Can you hold it up to your mouth? Step closer to you there.
Wrong direction. So,
six more charter schools?
Actually, there's 11 proposals in different sites in Richmond this year, my understanding is. And the charter school administrators are pushing their students to get these so there's no oversight. So there's no, they didn't want any conditional use permits wherever they go. Where the issues are, I think, is like industrial areas. conflict with land use, and tax base, jobs, good jobs. That was the whole purpose for industrial sites, is that they be segregated, because they have to have cheaper land. Well, it's also the same thing that the school district wants, it's cheap land. So you're always going to have this conflict. So it's important that at least there be a conditional use permit required for these. They're pushing that there not be, and I'm trying to ensure that they do, or not allowed at all in industrial areas. And also, I have a concern about having it placed in regional shopping centers. It's just a conflict of uses. Students aren't the ones with the money. It's regional shopping centers for retail use, and school districts are not appropriate there. Maybe on the fringes, but not in the center itself. I didn't want to get into unions, but I've been a union steward before, so I'm all for you guys. Thank you.
Those that don't know me, I'm Sandy Brown. I'm an area supervisor for the school district. I have 29 of the schools assigned to me. I started my research on charter 2 years ago. And then 18 months ago, oh, by the way, 2 years ago, I started going to every board meeting. And I've only missed three due to vacation. So 18 months ago, I was at the board meeting when Liz Block and Valerie Cuevas took their oath and all teary-eyed. And every board meeting after that, I just kept noticing more charter agenda. The board meetings would last longer and last longer. So I dove into even more research of those two, and I'm now an expert on charter schools. I can tell you when it started. I can tell you when we started attacking the teachers' union. This is such a well-orchestrated takeover in this country. And it's, and at this point, I mean, to me, I started out, I liked charters. I had no knowledge of charters. So I did the homework, and I started out with an open mind with a pros and cons list. And the con list just kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And the more I dove into it, I realized exactly what was happening. And it was a hostile takeover of the traditional public school system to privatize and for marketing. In the 2 years that I've been at every board meeting fighting the charters, and going to every school. I have an opportunity to be in every single school in this district, and I am in every single school. And I don't just go in and take care of my business. I go in every campus I enter with the eyes of a parent. And then once I'm in that campus and I've realized the things that the parents are seeing that are wrong, I start preaching to each and every employee. And I have that opportunity because I know just about every employee. I am on the board of my own union, Local 21. I'm a delegate for the Contra Costa Labor Council on their school committee. So everybody that I know in the school district has heard my spiel about charter schools and what we need to do. I started pounding the unions long ago, saying, please, 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 you guys need to pay attention. This is what's coming up. They're sneaking up on us. Little by little, they snuck up on us. And then just recently, I decided, let me go back and look at the notes that I've made, massive notebooks of 18 months ago. And I found the timeline that I had made and with my research of other districts our size that were going through the same thing in the country. And I was able to come up with a timeline when I knew that the district was going to run out of facilities to give to the charters. My timeline was the school year of 17-18. So this has creeped up so fast on us to be where we are today. If the Adams sale does not happen for 60,000, even though I bid 61 and no one took it, if it doesn't happen, then we have to pick a school to close. That's all there is to it. We don't have a choice. And lately I've been thinking, how long is it going to take? It's taken me 2 years to get where I am with getting the unions on board, getting the employees on board, talking to the parents. I asked the parents at the charters, why are you taking your kids out of the schools? I listened to everything they say. A lot of it is our school district. A lot of it is our employee entitlement. A lot of it is that we've lost our oomph, and it was a given that these children are ours. So in a sense, we've lost it as a school district, and we've lost it in the country also. But with the help of the charter schools, making sure that we all know that the school systems are failing and they're not. And that was their narrative. That, you know, oh my God, they did studies, the school system's failing, everybody jumped on board, and we all thought it was a wonderful idea to bring the charters in. At this point, I think with for West Contra Costa, for our school district alone, I am convinced if we don't sell the property, we will close the school. For me, we're taking the children out of their community and their school. For me, as a union president, I mean a union board member and a delegate of the Contra Costa Labor Council, it's jobs. Once we close that school, seniority employees are going to start bumping, and it's going to go on down the list. The charter schools are going to come quicker. We're going to give John Henry, or the school next to Nystrom, we're going to give Nystrom's portables that they've been in for 4 years. We're going to go ahead and get, it's a done deal. They get those facilities that Nystrom's moving out next in 2 weeks. So after that, and I do believe, I forgot the name, but there is another charter school in the wings ready to apply. So after that, every single charter school that's going to come into this district, and they're coming quick, because we have the large LCAP. We have the large free and reduced. So that's what, and they don't want the districts that they don't go into Albany and take Albany over. They're not going into these districts where there's not a high free and reduced. They just want that local control funding. They know that the loopholes, they know that what they can do. I'm at the point now where I still want to fight charters, and I will never stop fighting charters. My concern right now is, one, what school are we going to start closing next? Because in the time it's going to take us as unions to get together, as coalitions to get together to fight this in this area, I think we're a little too late, personally. But to me, just the price alone for Adams is worth the fight. My goal, and has been my goal for the past few months, as an employee of the district, is to start turning around and changing the discussion we're having amongst ourselves as employees. I can't tell you how many times I've been into our schools where people didn't know me at first, and I walk in and I'm treated so badly, before they even know who I am, I'm treated so badly and disrespectful. And I keep thinking to myself, this is over and over and over and over the 11 years that I've been here and trying to work. We've got to change the way that we're dealing with our parents. These are our customers that we have lost. And it's time that we reclaim our parents, we reclaim our schools, we reclaim our students. And the only way for us to do that as a district right now, because I do see that Dr. Harder feels this way too. Every Monday morning he's putting out that positive message. The brochures that he's putting out lately, the billboards that he's putting up, it's driven to say that the only way that we're going to win this war now is by us being the right choice. Our school district has got to be the right choice. And Contra Costa Times has made sure that we look bad. I go into every school. I know what programs are in these schools. I know the good principals. I know the good teachers. I know the good things that the district is doing that doesn't get shined on. And the parents don't know that we are increasing our scores. We are doing a lot better at what we're doing in educating our children. But I think, and after talking to the parents at the board meetings, or standing there watching the parents of our own schools, to me, I'm thinking to myself every board meeting, why are these parents making it up to the board meeting to complain about us? Why aren't we taking care of these problems at the school site? Take care of the problems before they get up to the board and say, you guys suck. You guys did this, you guys did that. But no one's standing up and saying, you know, I was at Paris the other day, or I was at Montalvin the other day, and they have such a wonderful program. No one ever hears that. And I decided to turn that around a couple months ago, and I thought, I'm a proud district employee, so I'm going to start educating our employees. It's my job to educate the employees and say, we need to reclaim everything back. And the way to start is gearing up with our customer service within our schools and how we're dealing with our community and our parents. And shining the lights on the schools that are doing wonderful jobs and the principals and the staff. I email, when I go into a school and I see something down, I'm emailing everybody. I'm emailing Dr. Harder, I'm emailing HR, I'm emailing anybody I can email, say, look, I was at this school today, I was so blown away by how wonderful they did, or what program they have. And now I'm starting to get feedback. I'm emailing the principal saying, I walked into your school today and that staff didn't know who I was, unbelievably, but she treated me with respect. I emailed the supervisors of my union saying, you know, I was at Lupine today and I saw a parent that's pretty new to the school asking the custodian some questions. He was so helpful to that parent. And she walked away happy as could be. And without even saying anything, then I thought, you know, let me just go straight to the HR. I emailed HR and said, he did a wonderful job. The parent was happy. And that's all it took to keep that child in that school, is that parent is happy. She knows that she's getting taken care of. And I think that's what we really need to focus on right now to save our school district. It's a big job to save the what's going on with the charters in the country. All the charters are mirroring each other. I mean, all the districts are mirroring each other now, all the free, high, free, and reduced districts. Whatever goes on in LA, it's going to go on here. The same day that they filed a lawsuit with us to take our parcel tax, it was the same day that they filed the same lawsuit with LA. It's the same lack of opposition that we're going through here in this. And it's been a long time. And now I see that people are starting to say, hey, this is not right anymore. So to summarize what I think that where we are now and what I think that we need to do being in the district this many years and being so involved and educating myself so much on this is right now is to focus on stop closing our schools. What can we do? Because it is going to be the next charter. It will be within the next school year that we're going to start, we'll close this first school, do the charters. I don't want children to be taken out of one school and jammed in into another school. Now we got overcrowded and we're going to fail at that, and what's going to make our test scores look even more impossible to bring up than they already are. I think that we need to focus on, and I will work with the district and the unions, on the customer service. I am holding the district accountable. I can't tell you how many times they keep shooting themselves in their foot or giving themselves their own black eyes. Even though they're really trying at this, I'm holding them accountable. I get on the phone and say, what are you doing? This makes us look bad. Your decision made us look bad and you made us take two steps back in the fight that we're doing now. So by holding the school district accountable and by holding our employees accountable and saying, you have got to change the conversation, we've got to change the tone that we are talking to our parents and get our parents back into the school system. The only way to win is making us the right choice at this point.
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Mike Parker. I'm active with the Richmond Progressive Alliance, and I've also been very involved in this charter school issue. This is obviously a question of a political struggle of massive proportions. Let's take Richmond, for instance. Look, the fundamental problem is that the Richmond schools are having a very difficult time doing the difficult job they have to do because they're underfunded. If you can't keep good teachers in the school district because you're not paying enough, if you can't provide enough teachers to be able to lower class sizes so you can help the special needs kids, you're just basically setting it up so that the charter schools can do the programs that they have and rip off the students and the resources they can. Why is that happening? Because it's a conscious, political, ideological view that what you have to do if you're a right winger in this country, is you have to starve the public school system, you have to starve all public programs in order to prove that they don't work, and then they have to then put them off into private hands. And that's really what's going on. There's no difference. The problem is, what do we do about it? We can't, in this week, this month, we're not going to change the state legislature. In this week, this month, we're not going to be able to get the money that we need to fund the schools. We're not going to be able to get these awful laws that are passed at a state level that permit the charters to do all these things. We have to start by building up that fight and building the resistance here in this community. Now, I was actually quite inspired last Wednesday at the school board meeting. Why? Because for the last 2 years, I've been to city councils, school board meetings, planning commissions, and the like, where the charter schools bring out hundreds of people, and nobody stands up and speaks for public education and public schools. When we had the Promise Program in Richmond, for instance, the charter schools were able to mobilize people so that the charter schools got their big piece of the pie. Actually, they're getting a bigger piece of the pie than the other schools. And only a handful of people were willing to stand up against the charter schools in that. So what do we do? Well, the first thing is there's exciting things that are happening. So, but they're all individual fights. There's the fight here about the charters on Hilltop. There's the fight about Adams. There are some new groups that are forming. There's a group I want to recommend very highly called Public Core. You can find it at publiccore.net, which has been trying to get out all the information about charter schools and create the kind of atmosphere in this city where people are willing to stand up and publicly identify against charter schools, which so many people are afraid to do. If you want to get all the information that you've heard earlier and see where all the articles are, which say all these things about charter schools, go to publiccore.net. There's also something called the Alliance for Public Education, which doesn't have an official view about charter schools, but sees itself as primarily fighting to support the public schools here in the West County. But the biggest issue we have to face is that this school district is at a tipping point. There are two people on the school board who are pro-public, who are pro-charters. They got elected with the money of the charter schools. You heard that earlier. There's a school board election coming up in the fall where only two candidates are up for election, but those are two that have been more resistant than the others to the charter schools. Look, the school board's been terrible on this question. It hasn't been willing to stand up and fight. There's a lot of timidity there. There are people on the board who supposedly are for public schools, but who are only willing to say, well, you know, there's a law, and we have to be worried about lawsuits, and we can't stand up. And they're bending over backwards to avoid any conflict with the charter schools, which is why they ended up putting Caliber at the front of the line on this question of who gets the facilities now, even though there are lots of places that are in portables and temporaries. You know, why does Caliber get to go to the front of the line? Well, we know the reason. That's because they're politically organized. We have to do the same. The charter schools are going to focus on two candidates this fall. We have to be willing to do the work necessary to counter all of their money. And the only way we can do that is we aren't going to get a lot of money. We're going to have to do it with legwork. We're going to have to do it by being willing to go out and explain these issues to people in West Contra Costa that why they cannot vote for those charter school candidates. That's what we have to do. And we can't just say, don't vote for the charter schools. We have to present a real alternative to people. Candidates who are willing to get up and speak out against the charter schools and are willing to explain why the public school system is vital for democracy. So there are some things happening right now. There are lots of different groups. The UTR, I'm very happy to say, has taken the lead in terms of trying to mobilize and educate in this area. But other groups are starting to come together. And hopefully in the next month, there'll be some meeting where we'll be able to bring together most of these groups that have an interest in maintaining the public school systems together so there can be a real fight. Because I loved everything that people said, but the one thing I disagreed with that was said here today was there's no way that the charter schools are going to dry up and blow away. They're backed by a whole lot of money, And that's going to keep them going as long as there's no power that's built to counter them. And we have to be the ones that say, we're going to build that.
My name is Hugh Barnett, and I teach in Vallejo. And I've been in education for about 25 years. I'm a high school teacher, and I teach at Vallejo High School, and I teach mathematics. One of the things I want to start off with is the school I teach at, we've had success. The biggest challenges we've had is working with administration and being able to have input into the decisions that are being made that allow for our students to have success. Now, I don't know how it is here in West Contra Costa, and I guess you guys can share with me later about this. But one of the things that I try to share with my administration is that, you know, we had shown success and growth in student passing the high school exit exam. Even though they kind of dismissed it, at our high school, the best we ever had was 3 out of every 5 students would pass, and we brought it up to a rate of 3 out of every 4. Now, that may seem like not a lot, but to me, that's significant, and it showed that we were doing something good, and we were doing something that was well, and doing something well as a math department. That being said, I also know the school that I worked at one point was a school that was looked upon as, you know, a kind of a beacon of the community in Vallejo. Now it's kind of like a war zone between administration and teachers. And the sad part that I find is that Caliber is getting ready to move in at one of our annexes, which is across the street from Vallejo High School next year. So, and I think what's going to end up happening, because our school is kind of disintegrating and losing that beacon, is that Caliber is going to shine compared to what we offer there now. And my biggest disappointment is that a lot of my colleagues are wanting, and a lot of teachers are wanting out of Vallejo High School. They don't want to work there because they're not respected. And even when we go to the school board there, even when we talk to our superintendent, it's almost like it falls on deaf ears, trying to get programs in there. And because not that we know everything about our kids, but to have some input and to see the things that we need at our school, you know, I think play a big part. Now, that being said, and trying to connect to what's going on here, is that I think ultimately we have to put out a product, and we need to have, when I say a product, meaning students that are achieving and that are doing well, and so that we can compete with the charter schools. I know I was shouting and screaming at the guy from Caliber when we were up in Mira Vista, just because he seemed like arrogant, he seemed very arrogant and disrespectful. And so it made it easy for me not to respect him. He didn't seem humble. He seemed like he had a lack of respect for this community. And I think that that's important, that, you know, that if you're coming somewhere as a guest, I don't care how much money you got, people are not going to respect you if you treat them. They don't treat you well. Now, one other thing I want to add, and this is kind of an observation that I'm making here, but it's also something that I've noticed in Vallejo as well, is that, as you guys indicated, the free and reduced lunch, or the number of students that are qualified to take free and reduced lunch is almost, for us, in the 70%. And so, but also it plays into, if you look at our student population, almost 70% of Vallejo High are black and brown students, would be African American Latino students. And I'm saying somehow there's a disconnect, and I feel like our administration is always able to play between that and making it an ethnic thing when it is a poverty thing. And so what I'm finding out when I look in this meeting, I see a lot of educated folks and a lot of educated white folks here. And I'm not knocking you for that, because that's a positive, and I think you want what's best for the community. But I'm also saying we've got to get out and reach out to those communities in the flatlands and educate them about what's going on. Because if we don't do that, then I think we're going to be fighting that battle, and then Caliber can just kind of come in and tell those folks, well, look at how bad those teachers are over at this school or at that school, and then ultimately they end up playing the game, similar to me to what our admin does in Vallejo. And I don't care if this gets back to them. Matter of fact, I hope it does get back to them, because I have my own sentiment. But my biggest concern is, because I live here in Richmond, I live right down on Warriors Road, and one of the things I'm going to close in saying is that I will support it any way I can. I'm like I said, I'm a lifelong educator. If there's something I can do to help, I will do it. I just hope that somehow we're able to educate the masses so that they can make good decisions and they can see that West County, the West County School District does offer something for their child and for their children. So thank you.
I want to thank all the teachers who are here. I have my own personal reason for having huge respect for teachers who can really do a good job. I taught in the district myself for 1 year. I taught at Lincoln Elementary, which is in the Iron Triangle, and I learned what a terrible thing it is to have a teacher in a classroom who just isn't good at it. So, thankfully for my students, I went on to other work. And so I just want to appreciate all the teachers for being here. I appreciate Sandy talking about the need for teachers and administrators to create the right choice for families in our public schools in West Contra Costa. I also want to think through with some folks about what, so we have to provide a viable alternative to the charter schools for families. I want to think through what's the viable alternative that we're providing to the district for the use of Adams Middle School. Is anybody proposing an alternative use? I have some friends and I who've been looking for land to buy in the Bay Area so that we could live together and put together organic gardening, and that site is big enough to have an environmental education center, to have a neighborhood playground, to have a dog park, to have all of that on site. There are things that benefit the community in ways that the community actually wants. Rather than bringing 800 students to a site that does not have adequate evacuation. So, and it's sitting on an earthquake fault. So, sit your charter school of 800 students on an earthquake fault, and then try to explain to us how you're going to get those kids out of there in the event of an earthquake, because there is just not adequate traffic for that. And that's something that should be addressed in a conditional use permit that should be required. So I'm interested in working with neighbors to put this together. We have some experience to bring to the table. So if anyone wants to participate in creating an alternative to the caliber proposal for that site, talk to me.
Good morning. Everybody want to stretch? Stretch a little bit? Yeah. Yeah. Great, great comments. It's good to listen to everybody. I'm Marilyn Langlois. I'm a co-founder and current co-coordinator of the Richmond Progressive Alliance. I've been involved with education issues, specifically around the high-stakes testing, going back 16, 17 years, quite a long time. And it's all related, as we know. About 15 years ago, I met a woman named Kathy Emery, who wrote a doctoral dissertation at UC Davis about how the involvement of the Business Roundtable in education in the United States, going back to the late 80s. And she published it in a book. I can't remember the name of it. It's something like How Corporations Are Taking Over Our Schools. Anyway, the points she made are that the agenda here, it goes well beyond privatization and the corporations making money through the charter movement. It's about taking all of our student populations, sorting them into the few who will go to the, you know, elite, join the elites, the vast majority who will be uncomplaining, compliant, low-wage workers, and the rest prison trap. And so, and the other key point she made is, in her research, she read all of the Business Roundtable's own articles, briefs, documents, and in Business Roundtable's own documents and their own strategy papers, buried away somewhere, she found their, the point they make to their members is the single most dangerous and threatening adversary to their agenda is when parents and teachers unite.
Yeah.
got to look at that question, and I'm not sure how to do it, but I have some ideas. We know that the charter movement, that's something that they do very well. They're part of the divide and conquer. The divide of the unionized teachers and the parents. Charters are very good at organizing their parents. I see it, I'm on the planning commission in Richmond. We've had, Jerry mentioned it, we've had charter school parents come and tell us we don't want to have to get a conditional use permit when the conditions on, you know, on their use permit make the school safer for their kids, better for their kids. But that's the extent to which the charter operators have organized them, met with them, primed them, given them their talking points. And then we've seen parents come out of a lot of these other venues in the school district. So how do we organize the public school parents? Mike mentioned the importance of organizing. It's really, really true. The teacher from Vallejo, I can't remember your name, talked about how do we get to the masses. I just want to, and Sandy said, we've got to get the parents and teachers together. One thing that Chris had reminded me, he said there are parents who do support us. And in fact, I've heard often when polls happen, if you poll people about schools, public schools in general, they'll usually say, oh, they're terrible. But if you poll people about the children, the schools that their own children attend in their own classroom, they're usually much more positive. So here's one thing, I mean, I just want to suggest one option, and there may be other ideas for how to really get parents and teachers together to organize massively on this, to promote public education. And while working on the issue of the high-stakes testing, it just seemed odd to me that most of the teachers I talked to, they know that the testing regime is not working, it's not good for kids, but they had no way of really discussing that openly and freely with groups of parents because the district wouldn't let them have meetings about this. Well, I'm just suggesting one idea is could the UTR explore the possibility of finding a way to assert the right of teachers to have meetings with parents of the children in their class to talk about important education issues of our day. For the district to not allow that seems to me both illegal and unconstitutional. So, for example, I don't know what back to school night is like now. Remember when my kids were at school, back to school night was a time when we all came and we sat in the classroom and the teacher gave us an overview of what they're going to do during the year in terms of the curriculum and their plans, and it was great, and then we asked questions afterwards. And if it's anything like that, fine. But maybe have like a back to school night one where you talk about your curriculum and your plans for the year. But how about having a back to school night two where teachers can invite parents of kids in their class to come and talk about important educational issues of our day. It could be testing, it could be charters, it could be some other things that have to do with policy decisions, and have those frank discussions. And insist on the right to do that. And we in the Richmond Progressive Alliance will help you advocate for that. Thank you.
I really, all that I want to say is I feel like we all agree. I don't think there's any disagreement in this room, and I don't think it's really necessary to go on and on about it. I think we need to figure out how to organize. I agree with the person from Vallejo that if we can't reach out to the communities, particularly the majority community in this district, which is black and brown parents, then we are not going to win anything. And I want to give you an example, and I don't, you know, it hasn't come up today, but it's still being, you know, there is a group called Go Public Schools West Contra Costa. I don't know if you've ever gotten their emails. They're really Go Charter Schools. But they're calling themselves Go Public Schools. And they've really fooled a lot of people. They fooled me because they organized a meeting. They called it Black Minds Matter. And they actually got the Ed Fund, the Ed Trust West, to which I'm not quite sure if they're neutral or not. But anyway, they issued a report. There are real problems in our district. There are real problems concerning the achievement of Latino and African American students and some Asian students, because we tend to have the more impoverished Asian communities who don't do well on the tests. If we don't recognize that and we don't really talk to the parents and try to figure out solutions, we are going to lose our fight against the charter schools. I don't think it's political posturing. I don't even think, you know, I think we all in our hearts know charter schools are really bad, not only for the unions, but for the community. Because, Sandy, you don't have to worry, the district is not going to have to offer a school, because some of the schools, the enrollment is going to shut them down. The low enrollment because the charter schools are taking the parents of the most successful students who know how to navigate. It's a whole thing of navigating the system. We have so many parents who feel so disenfranchised in the public schools. And I'm not sure if we're doing the best thing to keep them in the public schools. So I really think, and I don't think it's necessarily a question of educating, because as a white teacher, I don't want to educate a black or brown parent. I want to work with them. I want to understand what's going on in their home, in their community, and I want to be able to work with them to make it better. And I think really what parents want is they want their students to be successful. So if a charter school looks good, that's where they're going to go. And by the way, just to make clear about Caliber, you know, Goldman Sachs was one of the companies that have caused the problems in Vallejo, that caused the massive, you know, the home foreclosures and all that. The same thing in Richmond, and they're continuing. Now they come in and they're going to be the missionaries. We're going to help you. I don't make any money. This is what, you know, this is Ron Keller. I don't make any money. I do this out of the goodness of my heart. I'm coming because I want to help you. One guy in Richmond said, you don't look like Mother Teresa. I don't know. But it's real, this is their attitude. But anyway, I just want to say, I think we need to use this time. I think if UTR passed a resolution, we should be mobilizing teachers and parents as much as we can to come out. And I think it's really that we have to be very careful that we do not in any way misrepresent the parents who have brought their kids to charter schools, because I think that they are really trying. Black Minds Matter, let me just tell you right now, the only group that is talking about the problems with the achievement of black students in the district are the charter schools. So they are mounting a campaign to win over the few, because we've lost a lot of African-American enrollment. In Richmond, people have been dislocated because of gentrification, and they're being moved out in a big way. But if we don't begin talking about it and begin trying to figure out solutions, then the only voice that's going to be the charters, and it's a phony voice, but like they have the money and they have the communication.
Good morning, I'm Carlos Tawada. I've been a teacher in West Contra Costa for more than 21 years. I'm retired now, and I will be very brief. I know that I'm speaking to the choir here, so I'm not gonna enumerate all the evils that, you know, these vulture capitalists and charter schools are bringing, because we are familiar with those, but I do wanna talk about the choir and about the tune that we're singing. And I think that we need to think a lot about our tactics and what we are doing and how we are doing it. I have been, like you, I haven't been going to every school board meeting, but the few that I have been to, I have been terribly disappointed at the lack of presence that we have, okay? We need to learn from our enemies, and you are right, we are at war, and it is a class war. And at this time in this society, we are more and more open to using those terms. 20 years ago, you couldn't use the term class, social class, or class warfare, or class struggle. Those terms are now becoming more and more acceptable. See, and we should learn from our enemies. They don't think twice about talking to their parents and their students and bringing them and telling them what they're doing and carrying them to the meetings. Why don't we do that? We should do that. And we should also make the district accountable, because a lot of what is happening is because of the failures of the district, academic failures. We should keep in mind one thing. See, this privatization didn't begin yesterday, okay? The curriculum, the programs, the academic programs in our high schools are de facto privatized already. The national academies or whatever they call themselves, they go into high schools and with $80,000 per academy, they buy a teacher, they get him a free period, you know, and with no accountability from either the district or the principal, and they already have a prescriptive curriculum, and representatives from those academies are even present at hiring when our unions are not. And I'm very happy to see one representative from other labor unions present here, and also very happy to know that our union, UTR, United Teachers of Richmond, is finally taking a stand on this issue. And I think that we should take a firm stand, and we should be seen at the next meeting, and I'm looking forward to a group discussion to see what are we gonna be doing next, 2 weeks from now. What is our position going to be? Because we should be there with one voice, one message. Bellum and those people, they have one message, very appealing, parents' choice. And like I said before, that's a perverted conception of what choice is, but they get away with it. I think that we have a better message, better issues. Money and democracy.
Yeah.
Money and democracy. An attack on our public schools is an attack on democracy. And these charter schools are using our tax dollars. See? And those are issues that the people in the community will listen to. And they are a powerful, very powerful group. This is an international and a national issue. But I think that a community of teachers, parents, and labor unions can put a stop to this. We should look at our other districts, to see what is happening. Take a look at Oakland. 49% of the high school students in Oakland are already in charter schools, and they're having something horrible called common enrollment now in Oakland. That's what is ahead for us. That's what's coming here. And we should address also those bureaucrats in our school.
My name is Bob Mandel. I'm an adult ed teacher in Richmond. We're not part of the union. I've been very reluctant to speak at this because I worked in Oakland for 24 years and lived through one great success and one terrible failure. Our strike in 1996, the longest in modern California teachers history, one reduced class size statewide in K-3, and it was a huge success. Our failure was we were not able to defeat the charters. And I want to make a very specific proposal to the UTR members in this room. One of the previous speakers suggested a back to school night. But I want to suggest an in-school day that the UTR, and this would take a great deal of internal organizing, schedule a day school-wide dedicated to discussing the issue of public schools and charter schools. We pulled a teach-in like that on Mumia Abu-Jamal in the Oakland schools. It was enormously controversial and got an enormous amount of attention. If UTR were to do this, maybe 6-8 weeks before the school board election, in coordination with our PA trying to do the groundwork outside, in door-to-door, you know, knocking to get people to vote for public school candidates. If we do teaching in 80% of the classrooms in the district. The kids will be talking about it. The kids will be taking it back to their parents. The media will be going crazy, and sometimes crazy is exactly what you want. And you have the ability to put the issue of charter schools four square on TV and in the on the radio and in print media and on social media every day. And I'll just say from the Oakland experience that when the union shows the guts to stand up and say, we've got the academic freedom to make this the subject for a day and bring in all the facts and figures, you have a chance.
Good morning, my name is Charles Smith. I'm a 43-year resident of Richmond. My children were raised and educated in Richmond. I was a 15-year member of the Teamsters. I was a 26-year member of Ask Me, Local 444, East Bay Mud. I was a chief steward for 15 years at East Bay Mud. So I had an opportunity. I also was a member, a delegate to the Alameda Labor Council and the Ask Me organization from Northern California. I think that everything that's been said here is good, except it's not the answer to anything. This man here started out with the answer. This is class warfare. This is not, let's be nice, let's have good schools for our kids. It ain't going to happen. The system is fixed. I know that. I know that as a union member. I know that the international presidents are bought off. They're rich people. They party with our enemies. I know that our labor councils slash building trades are co-opted. They're looking for buildings to build. They could care less. They'll build a prison to stick workers in. They don't care. Now, we had a unique experience take place here a couple weeks ago. We had the guy named Beller, who was a partner of Goldman Sachs, a partner with Goldman Sachs, a criminal organization that came close to bringing the world economy to its knees. And this guy was a partner at that time when they were doing that. But he could walk into the city of Richmond, which they devastated. They devastated. He was Genghis Khan. He walked into this city unnoticed. And he was here to clean house, to pick the bones, to take away our public schools. And nobody called him on it. No progressive organization was out there with placards saying, get the hell out of Richmond. You destroy our goddamn economy. You destroy our housing. You put people on the streets. Where were they at with the placards? Where was our leadership in Richmond? Where were the progressives? They knew about who he was. The progressives in this town are not progressive. They're barely liberal. They supported Obama. Obama appointed Eric Holder, Attorney General.
Arne Duncan.
But the thing is, when Goldman Sachs should have went to prison, they didn't go to prison because Eric Holder, the Attorney General, right-hand man to Obama, let them slide. That's a fact. I can show you the testimony. You can see it on YouTube, the testimony. Goldman Sachs told Eric Holder, You cannot prosecute us because it could harm a lot of people. And that's not fair to them. He and his, the Goldman Sachs lawyers, wrote the book on how to not put them in prison. Guess what? Eric Holder got up there and he said just what they told him to say. We can't put these people, we can't bring these people up because we're going to harm a lot of people in the process. That's against the laws. But he did. Two other people in the Obama administration also up there to put these bastards in prison where they belong. They said the same thing. Goldman Sachs was off the hook. Then, all three of them ended up in one of the highest priced law firms in the United States. They've been bought off, they did their job, and now they're guaranteed a lifetime of luxury. This is all a matter of record. This is not speculation.
Charles, can you wrap it up about one more minute?
I got a lot to say, but I don't know about that. But I'm going to tell you this. This community was destroyed by these people. And where are the progressives? Why weren't they? They knew about it. They knew about it. That man should have never been allowed. If the press would have been here and the issue would have been, this man destroyed our community, it would have changed everything. Because you've got to start where it's at. And like this man says, this is class warfare. They don't care about us. They're going to take care of the rich kids, they're going to take care of the talented kids, and the rest are going to sit in ghettos. And the ghettos aren't going to exist much longer in Richmond because the poor people are being kicked out to Antioch and Brentwood. They're not going to be here anymore. And that bastard Tom Butt is going to help that process.
I'm going to simply, I'm on the city council here in Richmond. And, you know, first of all, I want to say a few things about myself too. So my mom was a public school teacher in India. And she taught a school with exclusively low-income children. So from the time I was a small kid, you know, I've heard about all the issues that kind of school has. And my mom worked very hard, obviously. And I myself, you know, I am a volunteer with this group called Writer Coach Connection. So we go into high schools, we work one-on-one with the students to help them with their writing assignments. And I will be honest here, you know, there are aspects of charter schools that I like. They are more flexible in some ways. There are aspects of our public schools that I obviously like. But my approach is, you know, I see that there's far more need in our public schools. And so when I choose to involve myself, it's always with public schools. So I want to say a few things just as someone who is not part of the school system, as it were. My experience with public schools and with charters in terms of how they operate. Okay? So as a council member, have the charters reached out to me? Yes, they have. Sometimes it's because they want to get a job done. Sometimes they just want to reach out. How many folks from the public school system or the UTR have reached out to me so far? Well, I think you guys know the answer is zero. Okay. Again, when I go to a lot of public functions, we have a lot of tables. Almost any charter school that is coming into the area has a table. The table at all the different functions, all the different, you know, picnics. Have I really seen the local public school tabling there? Have I seen UTR tabling there? I haven't. Now, I know that UC schools. How many parents who want their children to be educated actually know about them? You know, the numbers came out the other day. We in West Park Cross County graduate more students than the state average. If you ask the kid or the parents who are taking their kids to charters, how many of them know about it? My guess would be not a whole lot. So I think part of the thing is that you have to be a bit more active about getting out there and informing people. And so I will say a few things about you know, what the city council is doing and a couple of things that I want to get into. So one thing that the city council will be doing is it will be looking at some of the codes, because as you know, a lot of charter schools want to move into commercial, light industrial areas, and the city is concerned that, you know, there aren't a lot of, you know, we have to figure out that this is actually an okay place for the schools to move in from the health perspective. Certainly from the environmental perspective, it's not good, because it means that the only way you get there is through cars. So that's not a good thing. It also means that the only students who are going to get there are students whose parents can drive them there. They don't really become public schools in that sense. So that's something that the city council is looking at. One thing that, you know, when I talk with the charter school people, I sometimes ask them, well, how often do you guys deal with parents? And they say, oh no, we don't, you know, it's not like it's because of the parents. We don't engage the parents much. And I say, how much? And they say, oh, we just, you know, our teachers just contact the parents about once every 2 weeks. Okay? And I want people here to think about how many times did they contact the parent of each child. And so one thing that I want to work with the school district on is at least a parental notification system. So once we have the new superintendent, I'm going to take this up and have some allies on the school board who are prepared to carry this forward. So that the parents know exactly what their kid is up to, what the teacher thinks the kid needs in terms of attention. And the other thing that I also, you know, this is something that is close to my heart, is that, you know, we just think about school in terms